Okay, so thank you very much. And first, I will make the assumption that some of you may be more confident in English than in French, and draw the direct corollary that I will perform the talk in English. So if you don't mind, I think it's better for everyone. And so thank you very much for the organizers to allow me to talk today about this joint work with Matthias Rousset and Gabriel Stolz. So Gabriel Stolz is my PhD supervisor at École des Ponts, and Matthias Rousset works at INRIA Rennes. And I will talk about Feynman-Kalkbrenner dynamics and their ergodic properties. So I will remain quite high level and not enter too much into detail so that you have some ideas of what we're doing. So basically, after some quick introduction, I will go through ergodic theory for Markov chains so that you have some ideas of what is known today, and explain briefly what we call Feynman-Kalkbrenner dynamics and what kind of results we can have on those. So what are we studying? It's simply Markov chains. So in a very simple framework, I define them by an operator. So I call it a transition operator. So it's a sequence of random elements, xn. And I define this sequence by the operator p, which is simply the probability of reaching a set S starting from a position x. So that's how I define my dynamics for any starting point and any set S. I define the probability of going into this set. And so it's a one-step dynamics. And so this is used for modeling many systems. So in my lab, we do a lot of statistical mechanics, quantum mechanics, like we study physical systems, and it's very natural to model molecules, set of atoms, like phase transitions. So basically, we have, as I will show, a deterministic part which minimizes the energy of the system and the noise that comes from a temperature. And so the small picture over here is just to remind that doing Markov chain, we will cure cancer, stop climate change, and save the world. Okay, so that I get a grant, and you know. And so what kind of models are we looking at? So it's just so that you have an idea of what we had in mind doing this model. So we take a sequence xn, and how do we evolve it? We have two terms. So you start from xn, and how do you get the next position? You have a force f, which typically derives from an energy. So minus gradient of h means that the physical system minimizes its energy. So that's simply what it means. And you have a noise term. So typically T is a temperature. So the higher the temperature, the more noise you have. And G is a noise. So typically Gaussian random variables or this kind of variables, the one you prefer. And you have a number of natural questions concerning such dynamics, so it's still quite general. And one of them is their long time behavior. So if you take such dynamics, what happens in the long time? So I will explain why it can be useful and interesting to study this. And then we study also the probabilities of fluctuations. So what does it mean that you have an average behavior in your system, and you want to study the probability that your system has a very unusual behavior. And that's where I will introduce the Feynman-Kalkbrenner models. And you have other questions like decorrelation times, linear response theory. You have other questions on these models. Good. So some facts about Markov chains. And first, what I mean by ergodicity in Markov chains. So basically, it's the idea that you have two ideas. You have the fact that there is an invariant measure in your system, which means that if your system has some probability of being at some position, you evolve it, and this probability does not change. So just to draw this, so X is my state space, say a cube. And so the invariant measure, what is it? It's if I take a set A and I have a probability mu star of A of being at this position, if I evolve my system, I have the same probability of being at this position. So that's why we call this invariant measure. And ergodicity, what does it mean? Is that if I start from anywhere, So let's say I start from position x0, or from an initial distribution mu. If I wait long enough, the distribution of the position will not change anymore, so it means that after a long time, I will have reached this average behavior, this ergodic behavior that does not change anymore in time. And this has a lot of applications. So in physics, typically, if you take a system and it blows up to infinity, it does not have an ergodic behavior, it means somehow that you have forgotten something in your system, so it's interesting for physicists. And it's also interesting for mathematicians for a number of reasons. So in my lab, we do a lot of numerical analysis, and the typical problem is when you take an equation that is well posed, you discretize it, you put it on your computer, and it blows up to your face. So these things happen. And so you want to study the stability of the numerical scheme to ensure that your discretization is correct and that you are not doing complete nonsense. So that's why we are studying this. So just it's one of the only equations of the talk. So it's one result on ergodic theory that was explained in a paper of Martin Haver and Jonathan Mattingly. And I like it because it's somehow very simple and very intuitive. So I will give an example afterwards. So the only thing that you have two assumptions in order for your dynamics to have an ergodic behavior, it's what we call a Lyapunov condition. So W is any function, and gamma is in 0, 1. P is the evolution of your dynamics. And basically, it says that you have an energy that decreases in time during your dynamics. So it's very natural. I will provide a simple example. And if you could have an energy that goes to infinity, it means somehow that your system can get lost to infinity. So this assumption is used to say that somehow you remain in a compact region of your state space. And the second assumption, we call it a minorization condition. So once you have ensured that your system goes back to a compact set, you ensure that you have what we call enough mixing somehow, we call it mixing, which means that there is a lower bound to the probability of going anywhere in a compact set. So C is a big enough compact set. And what does it mean? So it's just written with equations, but the sense is not very difficult. So if you have this compact set C, it means that starting from anywhere in this compact, you have some probability of going anywhere, which is given by the probability eta. And so it means that you move around in your system, and so that you mix. And these two assumptions ensure that if you start from any distribution mu, you will reach some average behavior that will not change anymore when you evolve the dynamics. Okay? And so just a simple example that I like because you can compute everything. So it's just for the force, you take something that brings you back to zero. So if x and y get large, you are brought back to zero. And in for this simple force, you see that it derives from a quadratic energy, so simply x squared plus y squared. And then for what I want to emphasize with this example is that the Lyapunov function is something that is abstract because you say, oh, there exists a Lyapunov function. But when you have a physical system that actually has an energy, it's very natural to choose this energy as a Lyapunov function, and you can show that this energy decreases in time. And if you simulate this dynamic, so you see that you have some excursions away from zero, and then it goes back to zero, and it will not go too far away from zero. And this is because the force derives from an energy, and that this energy cannot blow up in time. Okay? So back to Feynman-Kirch dynamics. So I will briefly explain why we study this and what are the kinds of questions we are looking at. So the idea is that when you have this ergodic behavior, one of the main things that we can do with it is compute integral, doing an average over time. So we'll average over the trajectory of xn, so your Markov chain. And in the long run, you will reach the average over the invariant measure. And one question is the probability of fluctuation, like what is the probability for a long but finite time that this average is very different for the, from the ergodic average. So for example, you have drawn a trajectory, a usual trajectory stays close to zero, and you're not lucky, you drew a trajectory that does something like that. And so actually, you are very far from your average. So this is both a theoretical problem, because actually it's a problem of large deviations and concentration of measure, but it's also very practical, because if you want to actually compute this probability, you will never draw a trajectory, or very rarely, a trajectory that has this kind of fluctuation. So you want to design numerical methods to compute this kind of probability that you have an unusual behavior. Okay, so this is where it starts being more difficult. I still have 10 minutes, that's it? Yeah, okay, good. So the idea of Feynman-Kac's dynamics is to give more weight to some trajectories that will be more relevant to others. So you have different ways of putting things, but I like this way because it's very algorithmic in some sense. You can put this into an algorithm. So actually, you say that if you take the expectation of a text function phi, you will draw a lot of trajectories that will have the average behavior, and in the end, you will not compute the probability of having a rare event. So the idea is to add some weight, that when you compute this kind of average, you put more importance in the regions where the function f is big. So if you think of f as a positive function, say, okay, if the trajectory has been has had large values of f, I will put more important weight to this trajectory. So from what I have drawn, all the trajectories remaining close to zero will have a very small statistical weight. And if I draw one trajectory like that, well, I only drew one, but I will give it a much more important weight. And so it will help the computing the probabilities of having such trajectories. So this is the reason why we want to study this. And if you look at this stuff, there is one problem, is that it's not a probability transition, because if you take phi equals to 1, you have expectation of this weight, and it's not equal to 1. So actually, it's not a probability transition. So one way of, somehow the most intuitive way of going back to probabilities is to renormalize by the total weight. And you see that this is actually a probability transition, because if you take phi equal to 1, have the ratio of two times the same thing, and it's just equal to 1. So you are actually transforming probability densities into probability densities, and you are very happy with it. So when I mean, just to be clear, expectation with respect to mu, it's that I start according to a distribution mu, and then I take the expectation with respect to all the trajectories, or the realization of the trajectories. And one other quantity that is of interest, so I will not expand about this, but for people doing large deviations, it's very important to study the total weight. And the idea is that it will grow or decrease exponentially fast. So if you take the logarithm and renormalize, you will get the typical length scale of the system. So it's also very important to study whether this limit is finite. And our problem was to know, is this dynamics ergodic? So if we wait a long time, do we reach stationary behavior by weighting the trajectories in such a way? And does this limit exist? And for what kind of dynamics and what kind of function f? And so actually, it was really not obvious at all. So the only works I know on this topic are the works of Del Moral and Alice Guillonnet. So Pierre Del Moral and Alice Guillonnet. And somehow they use the ergodic Dobruchin coefficient, which is somehow a subtle notion, so I did not know before that. And it enables to treat this non-linear semigroup, because you have this ratio. And we did something completely different, because what they did not work when the state space was not compact. And actually, we have results very similar to those of Martin Heuer and Jonathan Mattingly, so we tried to put it in the same way. So the key element for studying ergodicity of such stuff is to put this evolution operator. So P evolves the dynamics, and exponential F is the weight of the dynamics. And then we have the same kind of results. So if you have a Lyapunov function over this operator that evolves the dynamics and put a weight to the position, and that you have a minorization condition, so it's a little bit stronger that for any compact set you have some mixing inside the compact set, then you have an invariant measure for your process, and if you evolve in the long time, you have an ergodic behavior. So this is just some theory, it's not fun. What is fun, it's the algorithm, because you can actually run algorithms to observe this behavior. So how do you run this kind of algorithm? It's to run the dynamics, then you compute this weight, so you take the trajectory for some time, you compute the importance weight, so here f is minus x squared, so it means that the trajectories that go far away from zero will have a small weight, and then you resample. So here you see that the blue trajectory remained closer to zero, so if you select between the two trajectories, the blue will have a higher probability of being selected. Then, hop, so the green one is killed and brought back to the blue position. Then you rerun the dynamics. Then you have another selection. So you select the one basically closer to the center. And then you see that here the fact that you do not go away to infinity comes from the fact that the trajectories that go away to infinity have a small weight. And conversely, in this example, the dynamics is stable, so does not go to infinity, but the f gives larger values to the trajectories that go to the right. And so here you have a selection to the right, you evolve the dynamics, so here the blue should be selected to the green, and so you run again the dynamics, and here you see that you are selected towards the right, but the dynamics brings you back to the left. And so you have a trade-off between the dynamics and the weight you put on the trajectories. And actually, with the assumptions, we can quite finely say for what kind of function you have an ergodic behavior for which one you blow up. And so the conclusion is that you have okay, an ergodic theory for Markov chains. So it's an interesting problem in itself. It has been a long-running problem. And we can do the same thing for Feynman-Kax dynamics, which is quite funny because actually it's important theoretically, but you can run simulation and you can make them blow up. So it's always kind of fun, you know. You have fun as you can. An interesting fact is that you always have an interpretation in terms of energy. So you have somehow an energy that decreases in your system, and somehow the assumptions you have make some sense. So I think it's always pleasant, and future work about that is to translate the consequences of these results in terms of large deviations, so basically of probabilities of rare events in your system. So thank you very much for your attention.
Question?
So if we want to cure cancer and solve climate change as you proposed, then I guess the difficulty sometimes we want, I mean, it's not obvious what F we should select to see the small probability events we want to monitor, or is that an issue, or do you see what I mean? Or
you mean what kind of F?
Maybe I want to see if some event of small probability will happen, and I want to bias my simulations to see that. I have to select a suitable F or something, no?
Yes, so it's interesting because actually what we find is that for a given dynamics, so you have a dynamics and you want to find a probability of our event, for some F, it seems not to be well defined. At least as this dynamics, you a priori, you cannot bias the dynamics in such a way to observe the relevant. I don't know if it's from the point of view of this ergodic framework, you can find a limit f for which this dynamics is well defined. And if f grows too fast at infinity, the simulation will blow up and you don't have. I don't know if it answers your question.
In your simulation, you only split particles into two when you select one trajectory.
So in practice, do you split it into more than two? Okay, and so do you select more than one particle? Or?
Okay, so a very good question. So I cheated a little bit because actually for what I did, it's supposedly for an infinite number of replicas. So when we work with only with measures on the state space, it's supposedly with an infinite number of replicas. And then you should have results that when you approximate over a finite number of replicas, for a large enough number of replicas, you expect the correct behavior. Then in practice, it really depends on the system. And then it's an important issue because if simulating one system is very expensive, simulating 100 of them is sometimes not feasible, and simulating 1,000 of them. So then you have to combine with other techniques so as to reduce the required number of replicas. But it's clearly an issue in a practical situation.
Okay, so let's thanks.
Thank you.